with the idea of fingerprints and finger ridges and why your skin does not get pruny in water. So now we're looking at the dermis. And what I really, really want to stress, having talked to some of my 241 students this morning, some of this morning over at Seattle Central, and some of you here today, is do not study for 1 to 2 hours at a time nonstop. Some of you are guilty of still doing this. You do one PowerPoint slide at a time. You'll learn that slide before you go to the next slide. You do not have permission to go to the next slide. You can recite what is on this slide from memory. I'm trying to control the flood of information into your brain to a more manageable rate and a more manageable amount. That's the reason why I spent the first hour, the very first day, trying to give you the tools and the means to be as efficient as possible. You may sit there and stay for 2 or 3 hours, your old way, 2 hours nonstop. But because you're looking at something doesn't mean you're learning something. Try it my way, do it my way. You will learn more, you'll learn more quickly, and you'll remember it better. 30, 10, one PowerPoint slide at a time. Think about the fact that every spoonful of information, you gotta give your brain time to chew it and swallow it. Right? You got to give yourself time. So with that idea, the dermis. I'm going to remember that there are two major layers of the dermis. There's the papillary layer, and there's the reticular layer. I'm going to learn that layer of knowledge first. Right? Now, the papillary layer, I know, is containing areolar connective tissue. I know I can find capillaries in the papillary portion of the dermis. I really don't need to write that down because I have a diagram. I have several pictures that shows me that visually, that there are capillaries in the papillary portion of the dermis. I know there are also sensory receptors for like pressure and vibration and heat that are found in my papillary area. That's how I can tell if a mosquito lands on the back of my hand. The reticular layer, remember, I warned you in the early part of the integumentary lecture, is a stupid name. Because I hear reticular, I'm thinking, oh, that's loose connective tissue, all right? Some bozo, right, decided to change how you guys think about this. So you just have to man up, woman up, person up, and say, all right, reticular layer simply is the name of the majority of the dermis, and it is actually comprised of dense, irregular connective tissue. By now, you should be able to picture in your mind what dense, irregular connective tissue looks like. If not, we need to get through there ASAP. What happens on Monday? That's your first exam, right? That's where I got to get you there ASAP, all right? We'll address that topic a little more toward the end of today's lecture. All right, so I memorized this slide before I can go to the next, right? You must learn this slide, you must know this slide. Tell this slide to your dog, your cat, right? Or your imaginary friend. Now I can look at this and say, okay, now I can practice what I just learned. I know that the papillary is comprised of areolar, here comprised of dense irregular. I can see the fact that the capillaries and the sensory receptors are found in the papillary portion. I can remind myself that the epidermis is avascular, because there are no red and blue structures in my epidermis layer. I can even name all five layers for you right now.
You could. And I'm pretty sure I can do it too.
All right. Now, we're looking at what are called lines of cleavage. And I did not name it. Those of you that are already snickering, okay? Keep in mind that a lot of this stuff was discovered in the early 1800s, early 1900s, a very, very, very male-dominated field. So I got to get more women into the world of science. You guys have daughter cells, right? You have cleavage furrows. We have lines of cleavage, right? Now, what you need to think about is the significance of these lines of cleavage. First, you have to realize what they are. And what are lines of cleavage? Anybody know? Yeah. They're parallel bundles of collagen and elastic fibers. So it says so right there, okay? Now, you memorize that first, all right? Lines of cleavage are comprised of parallel bundles of collagen and elastin. Parallel bundles. Now, who cares about lines of cleavage? Well, because it determines or influences the rate of healing and scar formation in your tissues. You do not need to memorize the lines and where they are. You need to learn their significance. So if there's a wound or an incision that is made, right, perpendicular, what happens? Well, the tissue is slow to heal, and it forms a more pronounced scar. Whereas if the incision or the wound is made parallel with the lines of cleavage, or parallel with the parallel bundles of collagen elastic fibers, it heals faster and creates less of a pronounced scar. So the plastic surgeon would memorize all these lines and where they are, so I could cut with the grain, in a sense, to minimize your scar. So maybe tonight, go home and look at your body, look at the scars on your body, and notice where those scars are. Right? It's a really pronounced scar. More than likely, if you compare it to this diagram here, that wound went perpendicular to the lines of cleavage. For example, I have a really front scar that runs right along through here. It's kind of hard to see, but it kind of follows my lip. It's following the lines of cleavage around my mouth. When I was about 1.5, 2 years of age, the way the story goes, I remember nothing of this, probably because of PTSD. I was a little kid on a rocking horse, and I was in a race apparently. And I was winning, and I went too far forward. I went face first on a glass table. There was this tremendous ear-piercing scream that ran through the house to two houses down. My dad heard that scream, ran in, found my lip over here and me over here.
What?
And a massive pool of blood, of course, because I chopped my lower lip off, at least right over here. He grabbed me, took me to the surgeon, and the funny part is, the first emergency room doc said, "Oh, no problem, Mr. Moffitt. We'll sew him right up." And my dad said, "How?" "A couple of stitches." And my dad said, "If you touch my son, you're going to need a coroner. Get a plastic surgeon in here now. I had 300 stitches in here.
What?
100 on the inside, 100 in the middle, and 100 on the outside. Why is the scar so minimal and I can feel? Because the wound went with the lines of cleavage. I have a very pronounced scar on my little finger here. When I was about 3, I nearly sliced my fingertip off with a knife, and I went against the lines of cleavage. The scar will never go away, right? So when you look at wounds, to anticipate if there will be a scar or not, look at where it is in relation to these parallel bundles of collagen and elastic fibers. That'll give an idea of how well that will heal. All right, now we gotta look at some accessory structures, some things that are found with our skin. And we need to look at, basically, why you guys get goosebumps. And we talked about finger ridges, but we're going to talk about goosebumps that you guys get when you are in an emotional state, right? Or you get cold, or you get scared, right? You get goosebumps. Because there's a muscle that connects the base of the hair follicle to the base of the epidermis, right? And that's this erecti pili muscle that the first lab group was spending some time looking at this afternoon. But when that muscle contracts, I can either pull down on the epidermis, creating a bit of a divot, and when you get multiple muscles, I get sort of the effect of multiple divots. So if it were this, and then I have these are the hairs, then I would have this, I'd have a divot, and a divot, and then a divot, right? Well, that is the goosebump. By simply pulling down on opposite sides, I create a valley of tissue that makes the rest become a little more pronounced. Now, how many of you have kitty cats?
Cats.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, dog people? Okay. When your cat does this, right, or your dog, right, and you can see the fur in the back of your dog's neck becoming fluffier and standing upright, or your cat arcs their back and their fur begins to stand out. That's because they're using the goosebump idea. They're contracting their erecti pili muscle, making the hair stand up. Because the reason for goosebumps is to do one of two things. To make you look bigger by puffing your fur up, or by helping you to stay warm, or stay warmer as a layer of insulation. Now, when you guys get goosebumps, it's because you're cold. How hairy are you guys compared to a chimpanzee? Who is hairier, a chimpanzee or you guys? Nope. Just as hairy as you. You have just as many hair follicles as the chimpanzee does. I'm just going, no, I don't, dude. Don't insult me like that. All right? Think of this. right? When you come out of the shower, right, and you give yourself goosebumps, you have what you guys call peach fuzz, right? Well, what is peach fuzz? It's just really refined hairs. The hairs are getting smaller and smaller because we don't need them anymore because we wear clothing and we influence our environment by having air conditioning and a heating system. I don't need to have my hair stand up on end to create a layer of insulation. But evolutionarily, we still have that. So when you get cold, you get the goose bumps that your body trying to make the hair stand up on end. They used to be longer and coarser. They would fall over each other, creating a woven layer of hair with air trapped underneath it against your skin. That's why birds puff up in the winter, right? Fluff their feathers up, create a pocket of air. We still do it, and that's why we get the goosebumps, because the recti pili is contracting. But there's also another reason for getting goosebumps. And so I want to try this little experiment on you guys. Okay. Let's test the volume here. This isn't too loud. Hi, what's your name, darling?
My name is Susan Boyle.
Okay, Susan, where are you from?
I'm from Whitehall near Barclay, West London.
That's a big town.
It's a collection of villages. That's effective.
And how old are you, Susan?
I am 47. And that's just one side of me.
Hey.
Okay, what's the dream?
I'm trying to be a professional singer.
And why hasn't it... Look at her reaction.
Rude.
Are you freaking kidding me? No way in hell.
It worked out so far, Susan.
Well, I've been given the chance before, but here's hoping it'll change.
Okay, and who would you like to be as successful as?
Elaine Page.
What are you going to sing tonight?
I'm going to sing I Dreamed a Dream from the Wizard of Oz.
You know those negative facial expressions? Face audience?
Yeah.
Emotional issue. You expected her to not sing that well. But all of a sudden, holy crap. Here comes this voice out of this person you didn't expect. And when you get goosebumps when you hear certain songs or hear certain things or see certain scenes in a movie, right? It isn't... And I remember when one of my friends saying, well, that's the Holy Spirit touching you. No, it's friction. Right? There's a physiological reason this is happening. Is that you're activating your erecti pili muscles. Now, we don't know really why it's doing that, but it is related to empathy. And an issue where there's a conflict between you expect something and something different actually happens. Or maybe for some of you, if that didn't get to you, here's another well-known song that is good for eliciting phrasing. Not everybody gets it, but there are some really classical songs, and Susan Boyle up there was one of the classic examples of that. She actually did go to sing with Ellen Page, or whatever, Ellen Page, and make a Christmas album out of it. But there's another popular song that might give you goosebumps.
I know just how to whisper, and I know just how to cry. I know just where to find the answers, and I know just how to lie. I know just how to fake it, and I know just how to scheme. I know just when to face the truth, and then I know just when to dream. And I know just where to touch you, and I know just what to prove.
got it, that's great. If you didn't, doesn't mean you're not empathic to individual, right? It's just that stimulus didn't get to you. But if you now in the future, right, if you watch a scene in a movie or in a play, or you hear a song or hear someone say something and you get goosebumps, right, that's actually frisson. That is we think a effect of mirror neurons and our ability to examine what we weren't expecting to take place with them. All right. Now we're looking at this. This is an exercise in practicing how you need to learn information, how you need to remember information. I know there are two major categories of glands in the body. There's endocrine and exocrine. I know there's two different types of exocrine glands found in my skin.